Every member of the House, please take their seats. Every member. House will be in order. Mr. Doorkeeper.
Mr. Speaker, the judges of the Supreme Court, the judges of the Court of Appeals await entrance to the House chamber.
Mr. Doorkeeper, please admit the justices of the Supreme Court of Georgia and the judges of the Court of Appeals of Georgia, led by Chief Justice Hugh P. Thompson and Chief Judge Herbert E. Phipps, to the chamber of this House. While the judiciary is taking their seats, the chair appoints as a committee of escort to escort the governor of Georgia into the chamber of the House the following House members: Representative Coomer, Representative Nimmer, Representative Terry Rogers, Representative Dickey, Representative Donahue, Representative Hawkins, and Representative Carl Rogers, all to be on the escort committee for the governor. Mr. Doorkeeper.
Mr. Speaker, the President, President Pro Tem, and the members of the Senate await entrance to this chamber.
Mr. Doorkeeper, please admit to this chamber the President of the Senate, Lieutenant Governor Cagle, President Pro Tem of the Senate, Senator Schaefer, the First Lady of the Senate, to the chamber, and the members of the State Senate. This joint session will please come to order. It is my distinct honor to introduce a leader that we served together early in our legislative careers. He is a friend. He's been a great leader for this state, been a great partner across the hall. Please welcome Georgia's Lieutenant Governor, the President of the Senate, Casey Cagle.
Thank you all very, very much. Mr. Sergeant at Arms.
Mr. President, His Excellency, the Honorable Nathan Deal and his committee of escort await admittance into this chamber.
Thank you, Mr. Sergeant at Arms. Please let the Excellency Governor, along with his escort committee, into the chamber at this time. Please join me in welcoming the Justices of the Supreme Court at this time. Also, the justices or the judges of the Court of Appeals as well. Glad to have you. So we would like to recognize in the gallery our constitutional officers of our great state as well. Along with the Consulate Corps as well. And obviously now, a person that I have grown to respect and appreciate for so many years, an individual that I had the privilege of serving with in this legislative body for a long time, from Blue Ridge, Georgia, my friend and our speaker, David Ralston. Also, please join me in welcoming our Speaker Pro Tem, Jan Jones, as well. Along with the President Pro Tem of the State Senate, David Schaefer, as well. And in the gallery, I'm very honored and pleased to have the First Lady of the State Senate, my lovely wife, Nita Cagle, as well. And also in the gallery, a wonderful lady that has been a phenomenal, phenomenal ambassador to this great state, toured 180 of our schools, reading to kids and giving so much of her love and her talent, our First Lady, Sandra Dill. And now it is obviously a great honor for me to recognize our governor. Our governor has served this state in so many capacities, not only in the Army, but also as a prosecutor, along with a judge. His obviously most important time was when he served in the state Senate as a president pro tem. But also as a United States Congressman. He is now our 82nd governor of this great state. He is an individual that has not only allowed Georgia to be the number one place to do business in, but he has been steadfast in his commitment to ensure that jobs are strong and that Georgia is strong. He has championed not only the criminal justice reform measures, but he has gone beyond that to make sure that futures are bright with his educational reform measures as well. He is an individual that works tirelessly. He has served our state with great dignity and with the kind of ethics and strong leadership that all of us enjoy. He is a person that is a native son of our great state, was born in Sandersville to two school teachers. A person who I am very proud to have known him for all the years that I have, but most importantly, not just to call him a friend, but also a great governor. Please join me in welcoming the 82nd governor of the state of Georgia, Nathan Dill.
Thank you very much. Thank you all. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Oh my goodness, I'm not going to go. Sandra, yeah. Well, thank you all. Please be seated. Lieutenant Governor Cagle, Speaker Ralston, President Pro Tem Schaefer, Speaker Pro Tem Jones, members of the General Assembly, constitutional officers, members of the Consular Corps, and my fellow Georgians. Today marks the fifth year that I've reported to you, the people's representatives, on the state of our state. This is our annual checkup exam on the body politic, where we measure our vitals, celebrate our areas of good health, and seek cures for the things that ail us. In each succeeding year, we've seen the green shoots of our economy grow a little taller. Each year, we've seen more Georgians return to work or get their job for the first time. Each year, we've seen hundreds of more businesses open or relocate here. Each year, steady revenue growth has allowed us to slowly mend the ravages wrought by the Great Recession. Now our economy is seeing positive growth, with thousands of new jobs added every month. We're seeing the telltale signs of cranes and bulldozers humming on newly cleared land. We're seeing home values recover, and Georgia families begin to rebuild their savings. And Georgia has been named the number one place in the nation in which to do business by several major rating agencies, and has repeated that designation by one of them already. In short, I'm here to report to you that the state of our state is strong and growing stronger every day. But for every milestone we reach, for every victory we attain, for every improvement we achieve, new challenges await. Certainly, there are those who focus only on the negative, zeroed in on areas where we should do better. They downplay any progress as not good enough. To them, I say, celebrating our progress puts our challenges in perspective and reminds us that together we can achieve greatness. Our shortcomings don't go unacknowledged. They are simply what we're going to address next. When focused only on the negative, the job before us can seem overwhelming. Those feelings are not new to our generation. Atop President Kennedy's desk sat a fisherman's prayer, which says this: O God, thy sea is so great, and my boat is so small. When confronting the challenges of 10 million people, challenges that can appear insurmountable, it's easy to feel that the tools that we have been given aren't up to the task. When it comes to our constituents' needs in education, health care, transportation, and public safety, the sea seems so great and our boat so small. We may have 10 million challenges, but remember, we also have 10 million oars. In the turbulent waters of the recession and recovery, we have rowed steadily forward. The synchronized beat of unified oars has set the rhythm for our economy. Georgians have spoken clearly that the conservative principles which have guided our decisions, the very ones that have brought us out of the recession, must continue to guide our future growth. These include keeping our government small, prioritizing and balancing our budget, and emphasizing a strong business climate. State government cannot address the legitimate needs of our citizens, however, without adequate revenue. Last year, we based our budget on an anticipated revenue growth of 3.4%. That was in keeping with our pattern of conservative budgeting. So, when fiscal year 2014 ended, our actual revenue was 4.8%. That differential between what we spent and what we collected is deposited into our rainy day fund. Every budget cycle since I have been governor, we have added to that fund so that it has increased by some 643% since I took office. Annual revenue growth, coupled with conservative spending and a growing rainy day fund, are positive evidence that Georgia is better today than it was this time last year. Since I took office, over 319,000 new private sector jobs have been created in Georgia, with nearly 93,000 of those coming in the past 12 months. The announcement last week that Mercedes-Benz USA is moving its North American headquarters to Georgia is further evidence that our state will continue to be a leader in job creation. But with job creation comes population growth. Georgia is now the eighth most populous state in the nation, moving from the number 10 position in just 4 short years. You know, people don't move to a state unless it provides them with opportunities. The Mercedes-Benz slogan is the best or nothing. The company that accepts nothing but the best chose Georgia. I'll take that. And in the near future, Porsche North America will open their headquarters near the Atlanta airport. But let's not forget our first major automotive manufacturer in modern times, Kia, which employs some 3,000 Georgians and whose supplier base continues to expand in our state. Kia's example told the world that we have the quality workforce and the business environment needed to thrive in the automotive industry. Key officials remind me often that their West Point, Georgia plant produces the highest quality vehicle in their worldwide chain. Furthermore, home prices are up in the past year and up significantly since 2011. An example of the resurgence of this sector and the confidence in the market. Construction, manufacturing, and other key Georgia industries continue to rebound. And as Georgians experience growth in their incomes, this leaves more money for the types of things our fellow citizens want to be doing, rather than just the essentials. Virtually every reliable indicator points to one thing: a growing economy. And to those of you who have been paying attention, you will notice that the unemployment rate, the prodigal son of indicators, is even falling back in line. For those who were too long unemployed or underemployed, for their relatives who watched them struggle to get hired, and for the Georgians who understand that a working economy is an economy in which people work, we are making a difference. The ocean of need is vast, but it's shrinking. And we will continue to close the distance between where we are and where we wish to be. Still, need does exist. Over 19,000 students dropped out between grades 9 and 12 over the past school year. That is far too many. Neither Georgia nor these young people can afford the disparaging effects that typically result from someone leaving high school prematurely. This is why, over the next few years, we intend to take a comprehensive look at how we can make K through 12 education more accessible and more effective. A child that does not graduate from high school is that much less prepared for the workforce, that much less prepared for college, and that much more prepared for a life behind bars. I'm establishing an education reform commission to study a number of questions regarding our education system, such as increasing access to Georgia's world-class early learning programs, recruiting and retaining high-quality teachers in our classrooms, and expanding school options for Georgia's families. This group, which will be composed of legislators, educators, and a variety of other stakeholders, will recommend potential improvements to me by August the 1st of this year. I fully anticipate this process to be as successful as the one involved in our justice reforms after which it is modeled. In addition, a subset of this group will examine the most appropriate ways to modernize our QBE funding formula from the 1980s. This model is older than every student in our classrooms and some of their parents. just as most of us would not dress our children in parachute pants and jelly shoes and would not teach them about computers on a Commodore 64. Neither should we educate them under a 1980s funding formula. Our students are now using iPads and Androids. Why tie them to a desk when technology can take them to the moon and back? This undertaking will require detailed work. My vision is to create a formula driven by student need that provides local schools and district leaders with real control and flexibility. It is our hope that funding changes based on the Commission's recommendations will go into effect as early as the 2016-2017 school year. While we must certainly address the outdated funding formula, education still remains a top priority in our budgets. This year's budget, coupled with my proposal for next year's budget, represents an infusion of over $1 billion additional dollars for K through 12 education. Working together, we have devoted the largest percentage of the state budget to K through 12 education of any governor and general assembly in the last 50 years. Now the focus is on turning those dollars into academic progress. I look forward to working with all of you as we accomplish that goal. However, no matter how well we fund education, the fact of the matter is that far too many students are trapped in a failing Georgia school. Roughly 23% of schools have received either a D or an F, which constitutes a failing grade, for the past 3 consecutive years. When the system fails, our children have little chance of succeeding. New options can enrich lives, brighten futures, and rekindle hope. 3 years ago, the legislators here called for, and the voters of this state overwhelmingly approved, the charter school amendment. I have good news. It's making a positive difference. This year, I am asking you to continue the trend of restoring hope and opportunity to areas of our state that could use a helping hand. I am proposing a constitutional amendment to establish an opportunity school district. It would authorize the state to step in and help rejuvenate failing public schools and rescue children languishing in them. This model has already been successfully used in other states. My office has been in contact with a student from New Orleans who tells us that he could not read until he was 12 years old. Now, because of the Recovery School District in New Orleans, Troy Simon is going to Bard College in New York, where he intends to earn a degree in American literature. His life has changed. There is perhaps no sweeter irony than a young man who could not read at all may one day teach others to read and read well. Let's stop making excuses. If we want to break the cycle of poverty, let's educate those children so that they have the skills to escape poverty. If we want to interrupt If we want to interrupt the cycle of dysfunctional families, let's educate the children in those homes so that their families of the future will return to normalcy. If we want our young people to have hope, let's give them the greatest beacon of hope we can confer on them, a quality education that leads to a good job, a stable family, and the stairway to the future. There will be those who will argue that the problem of failing schools can be solved by spending more money. They ignore the fact that many of our failing schools already spend far more money per child than the state average. The problem is not money. More money without fundamental changes in the delivery system will not alter the results. It will only make the state and local taxpayers greater enablers of chronic failure. If we take this step, more students will be able to gain employment, go to college when they graduate, more employers will be satisfied with our state's workforce, and more of their colleagues might just decide to locate in Georgia. Above all, students and parents will relinquish the burden of having nowhere to go to get a proper education, something no family should have to experience in the first place. Now, liberals cannot defend leaving a child trapped in a failing school that sentences them to a life of poverty. Conservatives like me cannot argue that each child in Georgia already has the same opportunity to succeed and compete on his or her own merits. We have a moral duty to help these children who cannot help themselves. The sea is great. And the boat is small, but the boat must not have first and second class seating. I am calling on you to do your part in this session to get this referendum on the ballot so that Georgians can assure that a child's hopes of success are not determined by his or her zip code. Our places of learning should be places where a child learns triumph, not defeat. We have experienced triumphs in our criminal justice system where we have tamed some rough seas. Working with those of you and here and those throughout our state, we have enhanced safety and nurtured second chances. We have combined taxpayer savings with personal salvation. In return, our reforms are closing that revolving door that has led too many Georgians back into our prison system. Crime may not pay, but stopping it does. I've already shared with you just last month and in the inaugural address the promising results of some of our efforts. My budget this year will reflect our commitment to these important reforms. The next step we're taking to improve our delivery of justice will further make Georgia a leader in this area. On many occasions, one troubled family or neighborhood will deal with a multiple of agencies, from pardons and parole, to DFACS, to the Department of Juvenile Justice, to the Department of Corrections. Under current policy, these agencies often do not coordinate effectively on these cases. This fails to bring a holistic approach to the needs at hand, and it doesn't deliver services efficiently. For this reason, I am proposing to create the Department of Community Supervision to eliminate redundancy and enhance communication between these related groups. This new agency will pull from the relevant existing portions of corrections, juvenile justice, and pardons and parole. While the Division of Family and Children Services will not contribute to the agency itself, we will be including the DFACS director on the Board of Community Supervision to facilitate the transfer of appropriate information. Recently, we have seen tremendous growth in the number of child welfare investigations, due in part to our 24-hour call center. This is why we will continue to fund additional resources to meet this unfortunate need, including support for 278 additional caseworkers. In addition, the Child Welfare Reform Council, which I created in 2014, has released its review on the Division of Family and Children's Services. To address some of the recommendations, I am proposing in my budget this year that we fund several upgrades. These will include a mentor program for supervisors, providing for greater career and salary growth for personnel, promoting the safety and the resources available to caseworkers, and enhancing recruitment and training of foster parents. By caring for our caseworkers and our foster parents, we can better care for our children in need. I am happy to say that the Council will continue its work into the upcoming year. One of our most vulnerable populations is our children who are suffering from seizures. Last year, I set in motion trials at our state medical school to test the possibility of using cannabis oil to treat severe seizures of these young people in a safe and non-intoxicating way. Those trials involving Georgia children have already begun and will continue to expand. This year, I hope to sign legislation to decriminalize cannabis oil in Georgia so that families who need it and who obtain it legally will not be prosecuted for possessing it. But let me be clear. I do not support the legalization of marijuana for recreational purposes. We're focused narrowly on an oil that contains fractional amounts of THC, the chemical in marijuana that intoxicates a user. We want to find a pathway to bring our children home from Colorado without becoming Colorado. We still face the significant and more complicated issue of access. That's why, in addition to decriminalization, I'm proposing a study committee to research a proper role for the state of Georgia in the ongoing debates about the types of medical conditions that can benefit from this product and how we can best address this in a logical and controlled manner. I know for many families, time is of the essence. I want us to answer the question of access as quickly as we possibly can, while going through the proper steps to ensure safety and compliance with federal laws. There is broad agreement that we must do something, and we can do something. Let us also agree that we must do it right. Even a small boat conquering the sea must dock every once in a while. We must therefore ensure that our network of bridges, roads, and other vital infrastructure are well maintained and that the increasing transportation needs of our population are met. So let me present to you our options. Since only three regions in the state invested in Plan A, a regional 1% sales tax for designated infrastructure projects, we acted to implement Plan B, which includes reprioritizing funding and a focus on the most essential projects that will target our most congested areas. For example, we are constructing new capacity express lanes along long stretches of I-75 and 575. We are also extending the managed lanes on I-85. Over the next 4 years, we will open to traffic more than $1.1 billion worth of new reliable interstate lanes in Metro Atlanta, the largest interstate expansion since the 1980s. Thank you. We're making further progress in the form of our I-285 Georgia 400 interchange, which will ease congestion for hundreds of thousands of travelers every day. But let us not forget those things we've already accomplished, including the removal of the tolls on Georgia 400, the opening of the I-85 Georgia 400 connector ramps, which many in our state are already using, and of course, we continue to construct the Jimmy DeLoach Parkway extension, the Fall Line Freeway, and other road improvements connecting our South Georgia cities. At the same time, another important project, other projects lack funding that are necessary to proceed. Let's bring us to our next option, Plan C, a transportation plan to which this General Assembly and I can agree that would address the ongoing needs of maintenance and repair, as well as freight corridor and other transportation improvements. I believe this is something that can and should be accomplished. A need does exist. The excise tax, which is a per gallon flat fee, has remained the same since 1971. That's 44 years. In that time, the fuel efficiency for the average vehicle has almost doubled, which means that the amount of excise tax collected for each mile driven has roughly been cut in half. And the federal government has mandated new standards that would again double the miles per gallon for the average vehicle over the next 10 years, meaning that the amount of excise tax collected for every mile traveled will continue to shrink every year. And that doesn't even count for inflation. In 2014 dollars, we collected approximately 17% less in state motor fuel funds per capita for transportation than we did a quarter of a century ago, in part because of greater fuel efficiency. At the same time, we now have millions of more people traveling on our roads. According to industry experts, simply maintaining what we currently have to our roadways requires a minimum of hundreds of millions of dollars in new revenue each year. Some industry experts even suggest it's more than $1 billion a year. Over the years, we've added more highway to monitor, patrol, and repair. In addition, our state has seen significantly more freight on our roadways, with more and more goods and raw materials entering through the Port of Savannah. We're already the second business container port on the East Coast, and we're getting busier. It's estimated that truck traffic out of the port will increase by 50% in less than 10 years. We have to be ready to meet that need. Without this proposed Plan C, a new strategy for transportation investment, we will be forced to go to Plan D, which is to do nothing. If that is our plan, then our roads will simply slip into disrepair, the safety of our citizens will be jeopardized, and our economy will be stagnated by increased congestion. For me, that is unacceptable. We are currently operating at a rate that requires over 50 years to resurface every state road in Georgia. So, if your road is paved when you graduate from high school, by the time it is paved again, you will be eligible for Social Security. We must increase the percentage of roads being resurfaced annually. With only current funding levels, new capital projects will have to wait as we tend to our existing transportation network. If we do nothing, we would continue to have to depend on the federal government, whose transportation funds are also dwindling. If we should choose not to maintain and improve our infrastructure, Economic development would stall. Companies would be unable to conduct their business efficiently. Commuters would waste more time and gas sitting in traffic, and no one would be satisfied. For those of you who believe, as I do, that there are certain powers left to the states and to their citizens, a principle set forth in our nation's 10th Amendment, here is one way we can put our beliefs into practice. If we become less dependent on federal revenue for our transportation projects in Georgia, we will avoid some of the regulations and the extra costs associated with federal involvement. We will get more of our money for our money on new roads, and it will be one of the best signals that the state of Georgia is willing to spend our money to solve our problems. Four years ago, we decided that our state needed to develop its own reservoirs to be less dependent on federal water resources. Maybe it's time we apply that same logic to transportation. We must improve and maintain our roads and bridges. We must provide congestion relief, and we must prepare for more freight and more businesses. We can debate how much it will cost to do something, but let us not forget how much it will cost to do nothing. I do not believe that we Georgians will choose to do nothing. We know the problems. Let's now resolve to agree on the solutions. That's the outlook we must embrace as we tackle all of the challenges that I have discussed with you today. The sea is indeed vast, but our 10 million oars row onward. Let us, as the leaders of this state, demonstrate that we can row together in a sequence so that our boat will move steadily forward on a charted course of progress with the shoreline of promise and prosperity on the horizon. I pray for wisdom for all of us as we carry out the public's trust, so that we can give Georgians a state that is even better tomorrow than it is today. May God bless you, and may God continue to bless our great state of Georgia.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Governor. Wonderful words to challenge us all. Now I recognize the Sergeant-at-Arms, if you would please escort our distinguished Governor from the chamber at this time. Thank you. Chair now recognizes the distinguished Senate President Pro Tem.
Mr. President, I move that this joint session of the Georgia General Assembly be dissolved.
The senator has moved that this joint session be resolved. All of those in favor will say aye. All of those opposed, no.
No.
The ayes clearly have it. We are hereby dissolved.